Wait, we are now on Facebook. We're on Periscope, waiting on YouTube to connect us and get us fired up. And it looks like we are now live across the board. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to our channel. My name is Robert Gruler. I am a criminal defense attorney here in the R&R Law Group. We help people charged with crimes. Big news today, right? We had President Trump just came out and announced that his nominee to replace the late Justice Ginsburg is going to be Amy Coney Barrett. And we want to go through some analysis on this. We've been covering this story on this channel for the entire week, really. We've been watching sort of the horse race. Was it going to be Amy Coney Barrett? Was it going to be Barbara Lagoa? Was it going to be some sort of a dark horse that we just didn't know about? But it wasn't. It was Amy Coney Barrett. Now, this is not a surprise, I think, to anybody. We were following this along on Predict It for the entire week, and every day it just kept going up and up and up. We had more and more people saying that it was going to be her, and in fact, it was. It wasn't even that interesting. You know, it was kind of a exactly what we were expecting, really. And people, I think, think that Trump likes to do more of the apprentice stuff than he really does. You know, this wasn't a big reveal. This was just, hey, we're going to bring out Amy Coney Barrett and her family, and we are going to run with that. So we see here the family. This is just the nomination literally wrapped up like a minute ago. So this is her entire family with the president and the first lady. And it was a nice little ceremony. You know, it was all pretty generic stuff. Nothing really particularly exciting came out of it, but it is something I want to run through some highlights here just so we have it for the record. So President Trump came out and he did acknowledge Justice Ginsburg. He actually was, I think, very conciliatory to her and said that, you know, she left a very big mark on the country and her legacy is going to last for a long time. I think he was very, very generous about that and paid her some respect. And Amy Coney Barrett did the same thing. When she came out and when he announced her, the entire crowd out on the in the Rose Garden at the White House, they all gave her a standing ovation. And then President Trump went through her bio. So he explained that she was the executive editor of Law Review. That is, you know, it's a position that I think a lot of lawyers think is very important. I was one of the assistant editors or an associate editor in my law school when I was going through law school. And it was a good experience. I think it was valuable, but basically all you're doing on Law Review is just writing very detailed, articles about whatever issues you think are important, and then they consolidate them. So, for example, my article was all about immigration, the 14th Amendment. What does it really mean to be, you know, to be under the jurisdiction of a country? Does that confer citizenship? And there's all sorts of 30 pages of legal work, and that's an article. So the fact that she was the executive editor of Law Review means she's, you know, reading a ton, she's analyzing a ton, she's giving people critiques on their writing and telling them that's not a good legal argument, you're going to need to modify that. So, you know, it's a demanding position. Being the editor, the executive editor of a Law Review thing is a lot of work. And of course, that's what Amy Coney Barrett did. She was the first in her class, which is another nothing to scoff at there. She had the best record of scholarship, according to her, or according to President Trump, said that she clerked for Scalia. And then Scalia's wife was also there, which was sort of a neat little gesture there. They actually brought her to the ceremony, which is, I think, a nice thing to do. Now, I did not actually know this about Amy Coney Barrett, but this was something that, you know, that resonates with me. She has a Down syndrome son, and I have a Down syndrome brother. So, you know, there's sort of a special kinship that exists there when people have somebody special like that in their lives. So, you know, that was an interesting thing that I didn't know. I had read previously that she had a son with some special needs, but I didn't know specifically that it was Down syndrome. So, there's something special about that. I think unless you've spent a lot of time around Down syndrome people, it's hard to explain, but they are a special type of a person there. She is also the first mother of school children who's going to be on the Supreme Court. This was something when President Trump was actually announcing this, you know, he's reading from the teleprompter as he does. And as soon as that point came up, he sort of like looked at her and he went, oh, really? He's like, oh, you're going to be the first mother of school children. That's pretty cool. Like, he didn't know that that was actually something. You know, he sort of read it or learned about that for the first time on the Supreme Court. Don't know if he did or not, but it was amusing to me. She was then after that sort of biography from the president, Amy Coney Barrett came out, and then she said that she loves this country. You know, that was one of the first things that she said, and I wrote it down in highlights. I love the United States. I love the United States Constitution, and I agree with both of those statements, right? That's what we do here. We want to protect the Constitution. That's why we call it watching the watchers, because in my opinion, way too often, a lot of the people who are supposed to be protecting our liberties, protecting our freedoms, are actually the ones who are encroaching upon it. And so to hear her say that is a relief. Whether or not we're going to see that in her rulings and her opinions is going to be another story. Now, previously on this channel, we went through all of the cases, or not all of the cases, but you know, I think three or four cases. We did that on Wednesday or Tuesday this past week. I have those again, and I have some other cases that we can take a look at. But I want to know sort of, you know, what do you think about this? Drop some comments below. Are you enthusiastic about this? Are you concerned about this? We've sort of dissected this thing for a long time, and people are going to be falling into two camps in this regard. So on the one side, you've got people who think that, you know, this is a woman who is sort of the second coming of the founding fathers, right? You see that from a lot on the right. A lot of the conservatives, a lot of the Republicans are just, you know, doing cartwheels because they're so happy with this nominee. On the other side, the left, the Democrats, they are very upset about it, right? This is significant because this is a change in the balance of power on the Supreme Court. If you remember previously, it was a 5-4 split. And so this is what it looked like without Amy Coney Barrett. And this is what it's going to look like with her on the court. So this is the new breakdown of what the Supreme Court is going to look like. Ginsburg was here and her seat is currently vacant. So now we're going to be replacing Amy Coney Barrett in here, and she's going to make up the conservative wing of the court. So Alito, Kavanaugh, Gorsuch, we've got Thomas, Roberts, Amy Coney Barrett is going to be up in there. So it's going to be six right-wing conservative-ish judges versus these three, you know, Kagan, Sotomayor, and Stephen Breyer, who are going to be on the left wing of the court. So when you're talking about, you know, the Democratic Party, they're getting significantly outnumbered. It's not even really a close balance of power in the court anymore. It's now a 6-3 right-leaning court. And they're upset about that, right? Rightfully so. And so we see a lot of responses from them, sort of the mindset that this is going to be the end of women's rights. This is the end of legal abortion, and, you know, basically the end of the world for a lot of these people. There's actually been some kind of humorous reaction videos from a lot of people on Twitter and so forth. But, you know, the point is, I think that the volume on both sides is very high, little too high, probably a lot too high. And so what we want to do here on this channel is sort of, you know, analyze this, because what ends up happening, we saw this with Kavanaugh in a way that I haven't seen before. And, you know, it was one of the ones that I really looked at closely, but Gorsuch wasn't as bad. You know, during the Bush years, Alito wasn't as bad. Roberts wasn't as bad, you know, and we saw sort of the confirmation process with Sotomayor during the Obama years, and Kagan also during the Obama years. But Kavanaugh was something that was just sort of a different league, a different level of confirmation process. And so everybody's sort of wondering, what is going to happen with Amy Coney Barrett? This is a person who, by her resume, I think anybody can acknowledge, this person has been, you know, finely tuned to become a Supreme Court judge. This person is brilliant, at the top of their class. Doesn't really matter what their politics are, but this is somebody who is the cream of the crop in terms of legal expertise, legal abilities, and she's being nominated to the court. She's been highly vetted. She's got, you know, an amazing story, whether you want to agree with that or not. She has a story to tell, and this is going to be somebody I think is going to be a little bit more difficult to impugn than what we saw with Kavanaugh, quite frankly. There's also going to be a lot of election considerations that you know, the Democrats and the Republicans are going to be looking at as they go through the confirmation hearings. It's so close to the election. The Republicans have indicated they are going to ram this thing through, and the Democrats are going to have to, you know, have that conversation with themselves. What are they going, you know, how are they going to attack Amy Coney Barrett? What are they going to say? Because currently, my understanding is that Trump's campaign, his election, is really underwater with sort of white suburban women, and now they just nominated a white sort of suburban woman to the Supreme Court. So if they're going to be, you know, sort of attacking her in the same manner that they were attacking Kavanaugh, that may actually alienate those women who they're doing well with. So, you know, from the Democrats, they just, I think they're having to have that conversation with themselves. You know, what are they going to do? What is the approach that they're going to take? And we heard a little bit from Amy Coney Barrett, this afternoon. Nothing really particularly, you know, groundbreaking or insightful. She talked more about her relationship with Justice Scalia. She was a mentor, or he was her mentor. She actually clerked for him for a period of time. And, you know, she went through and told this story about her, about Justice Scalia having a good relationship with Justice Ginsburg, who of course just passed away, and said that even though they were on opposite sides of the aisle politically, they were very good friends on the court. They went to operas together and they had a long-lasting friendship. And sort of her point was that she can also, you know, join the court in a way that would be, she could be agreeable, or she could, they could disagree without being disagreeable, I think is sort of the where she was going with that. And she's going to judge, you know, the facts as they are in front of her. She's going to apply the Constitution. And she went into a pretty good background on her family. And then at the end of the event, they brought all of her children right up on there. And she had some, you know, she had this sort of this commentary that came out, which I thought was interesting. On Twitter this morning, I started to see other people who were saying, wait a minute, you know, sort of like this motherhood, kind of a woman like shaming, a woman scolding type of a thing. People were saying on Twitter that, you know, how can she raise seven children and be a judge in one of the most, you know, respected, prestigious institutions in our country, in the most respected, prestigious institutions in our country, the Supreme Court. You know, how can she keep that pace and also raise a family and also be a good mother? And that was something that popped up, and I thought that person was way off base. So did a lot of the commenters. But she, you know, I thought that's not even going to be a topic. Like, there's no way they're going to even bring that up. How can they claim that, you know, a woman sort of breaking through and getting onto the Supreme Court, you know, Justice Ginsburg led the way. Amy Coney Barrett's sort of following in those footsteps, also young, also the first mother of school children who's going to be on the court. Like, that's something to be celebrated, right? That's what we want. We want more diversity. We want more, you know, progress in all of these areas. So to see that response on Twitter was a little bit interesting to me. And I thought nobody else is going to talk about that. But I kind of picked up a little bit of that from Amy Coney Barrett's speech this afternoon. She said, she actually went through it and she said, my husband helps me a lot. You know, he's around. He asks me every day what he can do to help me. He, you know, asked me, she said that the kids joke that he's actually, a better cook, you know, sort of implying that she's not in this thing alone. She knows she's got a big family. She knows that that's going to be a criticism, and she's preemptively addressing it. Which was interesting. I didn't even think this was going to be an issue, but I think she kind of got out in front of it in order to address it. So who is Amy Coney Barrett? Remember, this is her. She is the former clerk to Judge Antonin Scalia, who was a very conservative court and sort of a conservative firebrand for a long time. He wrote some very interesting opinions on the Supreme Court. Sort of everybody liked to read his opinions. Even if you totally disagreed with him and didn't like the guy, he wrote some fireball opinions. Served as a law professor in Notre Dame. We also heard a little bit more about her husband. So Jesse Barrett, I didn't realize that he was actually in private practice. And this guy, right? And so when I am analyzing the Supreme Court judges for Watching the Watchers, I've gone through this previously on the channel. I have a certain sort of list of issues that I think are appropriate for what we do. I'm a criminal defense lawyer. I'm very interested in criminal justice. I want to see good people recover after they've been charged with crimes. I want them to reintegrate back into society. I want them to get their lives back on track. And so that's my profession. We have a whole company around it. We've got, you know, 24 employees here. We've got a whole team of people who are dedicated to helping good people facing criminal charges. So when I look at these judges, you know, I can tell you that specifically that most of the time, the conservative judges, the Republican judges, typically don't go in our favor. Okay, Justice Scalia, Justice Thomas, most of the judges on the right typically align themselves with the courts. I'm sorry, with the police and the prosecutors and the laws that are in place. You know, they see a situation. If it can go 50-50, the tie goes to the cop almost every time. You know, we kind of joke that they never met a cop that they didn't disbelieve. They just believe everything. And so from you know, from that perspective, a lot of the times these judges are difficult to sort of endorse because they're so bad on criminal justice. But what we're looking for is for judges who are in alignment with the Constitution and their interpretation of that Constitution, because the Bill of Rights provides some really strong, really fundamental protections for criminal defendants. We talk about the right to be free from searches and seizures, right? Warrantless searches and seizures, the right to counsel, the right to remain silent, you know, habeas corpus, and all of these other legal doctrines are critically important. So when we get a judge on the bench, we want to know what they're going to do. How are they going to interpret these things? And Amy Coney Barrett, you know, her record is a little bit unknown on some of these issues. We analyzed a couple of them. We'll run through them again today. But this was something that, you know, this is what I'm looking at. This is kind of the lens that I'm looking through to say, what are they going to do for criminal law? What are they going to do for the people who really don't have any defense? They are sort of looked at as the bottom of the barrel of society. We see this all over the place when we're watching people who are, you know, sort of involved in these Breonna Taylor situations, or Daniel Prude, or Jacob Blake, or Ahmaud Arbery. They always come out and they say those people basically don't deserve any rights. They don't deserve any due process because, well, they committed a crime 10 years ago, or because they were involved in the criminal legal world in some capacity. And they say suddenly they don't need any rights. Well, that's not the case. These are sort of the defenseless people. These are the people who need due process. They need the protections of the Bill of Rights more than anybody else. And so what are these judges doing to protect those rights and those freedoms? That's what I'm looking at. So like I said, we really don't know much about Amy Coney Barrett. I don't think she was a former prosecutor ever in any capacity, which is a good thing. Her husband was, though, and now he's working in criminal defense. So I want to show you a little bit more about him. The reason I think it's important is because it's her husband, right? When she comes home, they're going to be talking. They're both lawyers. They're going to be talking about these things. Now, you know, there's certain things that they won't talk about, but we all know that if you're married, you're going to talk about things. And, you know, that's the protection of a marriage. That's why you get married. That's why she talked about her husband and actually brought him in, you know, during her speech today and said, hey, he's super helpful and he's going to help me through this whole deal. This is who he is. He is somebody who has a lot of legal experience, just like Miss Coney Barrett. And he says that he practices on commercial litigation, internal investigations, and white collar criminal defense. So he actually does have some defense work. He used to be a prosecutor. So his 13 years as a federal prosecutor led him to investigations into a wide variety of cases, including commercial fraud and all that stuff. He has tried over 20 cases to jury verdict, numerous appeals. He was an adjunct professor at Notre Dame. Trial skills, criminal law, longtime South Bend residents, and Jesse and his wife have 7 children. And you see down here, one of his practice areas is criminal defense. So he was a federal prosecutor. He is now flipped over to some defense work along with commercial litigation and internal investigations. And that's a pretty common thing. A lot of prosecutors, after their career is sort of, you know, after they've gotten whatever they need out of the government, they'll flip over to the defense. But his resume is also pretty stellar. I mean, professor at Notre Dame, you know, he's got experience all over the place, U.S. attorney for a long period of time. So it's like the legal family. These kids, if they don't start a law firm together, I don't know what they're doing, because they have got the genes built in and just the family. I know some of the children are adopted. I think they're just going to be legal scholars just by osmosis, just by absorbing it from this household. And so we know a little bit more about Jesse Barrett, and I think that is, you know, that may actually be a good thing for criminal defendants, for people going through the justice system. He is now a criminal defense attorney in some capacity. Hopefully, you know, he is seeing some of the same plights that guys like me and the people at, you know, my office and other criminal defense attorneys around the country and around the world see on a daily basis. Some of the things that we talk about on this channel: problems with qualified immunity, problems with disclosure of evidence. Police don't tell us about the cops who've been in trouble or who are under internal investigation. Or, you know, in Phoenix here, our chief of police doesn't even really know what the heck is going on with the Brady system. There's been articles about that. So, you know, there are a lot of problems in place. And hopefully Jesse Barrett and his wife, you know, keep that cognizant as they are going through their cases that are in front of them and applying it, you know, applying the Constitution towards those facts and coming to legal conclusions. Amy Coney Barrett, if you do not remember, she comes from the Seventh Circuit. So this is over here, Illinois, Indiana, and Wisconsin. You know, these are three, you know, sort of the Rust Belt Midwest states that are going to be important for this upcoming election. So we'll see if that has any impact at all. Another reminder, we talked about this briefly, but Amy Coney Barrett currently is at the U.S. Court of Appeals. She's in the Seventh Circuit. And so she's at sort of this level where she is, you know, this is sort of the diagram of the courts in the United States. And so she's currently here. She's trying to work her way up to this location here, to the U.S. Supreme Court. And right now she's hearing appeals from all of these different district courts from those three different states that are within her circuit. And, you know, she's got, you know, a lot of experience there doing that as well. I think she was appointed in 2018. And I have a lot of her opinions that will dive into here in a minute. This was her law. This was some of her judicial philosophy. We heard a little bit about this today. She's an originalist. She clerked for Antonin Scalia. Basically, what an originalist means is that she's going to try to interpret the Constitution as it was written according to the understanding of the authors at the time of the writing. So when she's looking at the Constitution and say she's applying, you know, some provision of against warrantless searches and seizures, she's going to say, well, what were they talking about back in 1787 when they wrote that? What was going on then? Were they actually, you know, talking about this or that? And then they're going to try to apply that to the situation in 2020. So, you know, that's great, right? You can be in it. You can be an originalist and you can be somebody who focuses on that. But the real question is going to be what, you know, how is she doing that? Is she going in the Scalia model or is she going more in sort of the civil libertarian, more civil rights, civil liberties side of that, more like a Gorsuch? We just don't know yet. And her law school stuff doesn't tell us much about anything. These are just selected writings that we pulled from Wikipedia. All of these in the Notre Dame Law Review, you know, Texas Law Review. She's talking about precedent and canon and all this stuff. Nothing particularly interesting. We do go to one criminal case that I thought was a good one to talk about. This one is William Rainsberger versus Charles Benner. We talked about this, I think, on Tuesday this past week. And so if you are a regular of this channel and you've already seen this, I apologize. But if not, this will be good to know because we're talking about criminal law. By the way, hit the subscribe button because we're going to keep following this as it goes on. But this was a situation where there was a lying detective who wrote in a probable cause statement a lie that ended up getting this fellow, William Rainsberger, indicted for killing his mother. And it turns out that detective totally lied about it. And this guy's case was ultimately dismissed. And when the Rainsberger, who was originally charged with the crime, when his case was dismissed, he turned around and he sued the detective and said, listen, you falsified me. You falsified the charges against me. You wrote a fraudulent probable cause statement. And now I am, you know, I've got all these damages. I was in custody for a long period of time. I got legal bills. I've been, you know, sort of put through the ringer of the justice system. Now I'm going to sue you for damages. I want compensation. I'm going to sue the city. I'm going to sue everybody. And what this officer said was, you can't sue me. Why? Because I'm a cop and therefore I'm entitled to qualified immunity, which means I'm protected against those lawsuits, even though I lied in my document. So the officer's rationale was, yes, I lied, but it wasn't necessary. It wasn't critical to the probable cause statement. They could have all, you know, they could have gotten enough information about him anyways and indicted him, and they didn't need his lies in order to move forward with the case. And so on that argument, he's saying, I'm still protected by qualified immunity. To Amy Coney Barrett's credit, she was a part of this opinion. Now, actually, she wrote this opinion. So you can see here, she actually wrote this. She authored it. And the conclusion was that he is not entitled to qualified immunity. So she goes through and she says, he concedes for purposes of the appeal that he knowingly or recklessly made false statements. The detective made those false statements. He says, but misleading, whether by omissions or outright lies, only violates the Fourth Amendment if they were material to the probable cause. So he's saying they weren't that big of a deal, so it doesn't matter, so I'm still protected. He says that his were not material, but we disagree. Materiality depends on whether it demonstrates probable cause when the lies are taken out and so on and so forth, because it is clearly established that it violates the Fourth Amendment to use deliberately falsified allegations to demonstrate probable cause. This officer is not entitled to qualified immunity, and that means that the case can go forward. So, you know, from a criminal defense standpoint, that's a good that's a good ruling for us, right? If a cop is lying, literally, in their probable cause statements, which are used at the very outset of a criminal case, right when somebody gets arrested, they have to write a probable cause statement to justify the charges. They did that in this case, and they said, and the officer lied in it. So Amy Coney Barrett said, not entitled to qualified immunity. We have another case where we're talking about reasonable suspicion. This was a situation, it's called United States v. Watson, and this is where Amy Coney Barrett is actually, she authors this opinion as well. This case is a little bit different. She says the police received, this is about the Fourth Amendment, so searches and seizures. The other one was about qualified immunity. Here in U.S. v. Watson, she's saying that the police received an anonymous call from a 911 caller who said that there are kids playing with guns in a nearby parking lot. The cops showed up. They matched the 911 caller's description to the car. They found that blocked the car. They found the passenger in the car was David Watson, and he had a gun. So he pled guilty and then filed an appeal because he said that the cops came up and they were interfering with him without reasonable suspicion. So in order for the cops to come up and stop you and interrogate you, or, you know, they have to suspect some reasonable suspicion of a crime. There needs to be something. They can't just come up to you and say, hey, I'm going to have to check your wallet or your back pocket, or show me what's in your purse. They need to articulate something. And here, the issue was whether or not that phone call from 911 was enough for that officer to go ahead and move forward with the investigation of David Watson. And They agree. So Amy Coney Barrett said, no, there was no reasonable suspicion to block the car. The anonymous tip did not justify an immediate stop because the caller's report was not sufficiently reliable. The caller used a borrowed phone, which would make it difficult to find him, and his sighting of guns did not describe a likely emergency or crime. He had reported gun possession, which is lawful. We vacate the judgment and remand for further proceedings. Again, that's another Amy Coney Barrett decision. So, you know, this could have gone the other way. This is the type of opinion where a judge can look at the Fourth Amendment and then just sort of, you know, kind of tease through the facts a little bit and say, well, you know, there was sufficient, you know, the 911 caller, you know, he didn't say it was gray. He said it was a dark gray, and, you know, guns are dangerous. And so therefore we're going to find that the police have some sort of a community protection function and they can just ask questions. And so this case could have been interpreted differently. There's no question about it. And she fortunately came on the right side. She was on the side of the defendant against a bogus call, right? I mean, anybody, you can call somebody on 911 and say whatever you want. If that's enough to give the government an excuse to go into your residence, to go into your property, to go into your car, to go into your purse, that is a very low standard. Would you want to be the recipient of that, whether you're committing a crime or not? Probably not. But if you're standing there and a cop walks up to you and says, hey, open that up for me, you want to be able to say no. And if the cop says, well, I got a 911 call, so I have a right to go and check your stuff. And you say, well, I don't care. That's fine. Right, I'm entitled to have a gun here. This is America. So she was on the right side of that issue, and that's another good thing. Now, there are a lot of attorneys out there who are unhappy with Amy Coney Barrett, and there's two sides to all of this stuff, of course. But we're going to learn more about this as this continues to go on. There is a gentleman by the name of Robert Barnes, Barnes Law, big fan of him. I like his work. I like his legal analysis. He is not so happy with Amy Coney Barrett. His position was that they are going to have a difficult time getting her actually confirmed because it's going to give the Democrats a lot of fodder. And he says here, one of his tweets from September 21, I don't know what he has said thus far today, but he's saying, you know, she is more in alignment with the Scalia type of conservative judge. He's saying she sides with big government on almost every case, every big employer case, every criminal case, siding with the government on lockdowns, which I did read. I read that opinion and I agree. She did side with the government on the lockdowns, uncompensated takings, First Amendment infringements, Fourth Amendment infringements, and so on, right? So this is another attorney who is in the community, and he's got a lot of experience, you know, significantly more than I have, and he's read a lot of her opinions. And so he's coming to sort of the opposite conclusion as it relates to Amy Coney Barrett. And there's, you know, the cases just go on and on and on, and we could spend more time on that, but more will be revealed as we dive further into it. Now, if we talk about what we were looking at, there was another thing that I saw about the actual confirmation process, which was interesting, which I had not seen yet, and it involves a senator from the state of Arizona. Now, there's a lot of talk, and I don't know the specific legalities of how these elections work, but there's a lot of talk and some articles indicating that if the election happens and the confirmation hearings have not taken place and she has not already been seated onto the Supreme Court, so let's say the hearings are tentatively scheduled for the 12th, and I want to say the confirmation vote is scheduled for the following week or maybe 2 weeks later. So I don't know exactly when it is, but if that does not happen before the election, and Amy Coney Barrett is not seated before the election, and the election takes place, well, of course, the Senate could change, right? The president could change. So then what's going to happen? Well, Trump would still have a lame duck session if he loses this election and Joe Biden becomes a president, or even the Democrats take the Senate over, then they will have control. They'll have the ability to nominate somebody when they go into office, which will not take place until the following year in January. So from the election night on November 3rd up until, I think it's January 20th or something, I'm having a brain freeze on that one, but it's in January, and they'll have that period of time to once again move forward with the nomination. So if that happens, Trump could appoint somebody and get them nominated during the lame duck session. The Democratic Party, however, has a little bit of a rub in there. So in Arizona, our Senator Martha McSally was appointed by our governor, Doug Ducey, and she's been appointed there for a while. So this is a little bit different than a regularly elected senator. So the argument is that if Martha McSally loses her Senate seat to Mark Kelly, who is the former NASA astronaut, who I think is really neck and neck with her in the polls in our state, if she loses, then there's a good argument that that basically he takes that seat immediately. Okay, so that seat would flip from a Republican to a Democrat. So now what it would look like, this is what it looks like right now. We have the Republicans, there's 51 of them, plus if we add in Lisa Murkowski, that would make it 52. To the Democrats and the Independents, 48. So right now it's looking like Susan Collins is going to side and go against a vote on the Democrats. That was her initial statement. I haven't seen anything that would change that. But Lisa Murkowski has originally indicated that she doesn't want to vote for this. She said fair is fair, we're going to wait. Then she started to walk back that statement a little bit. So this would be 52 to 48 if these red lines and blue lines go the way they are. But if something changes, and we have a different situation where we have this flip, right? So let's say, so if we go here, so here would be 52 to 48, and we have Martha McSally. We don't have anybody down here. Let me get rid of me. We do not have Mark Kelly over here. But if we lose Martha McSally, or if Arizona, you know, switches from Martha McSally to Mark Kelly, then this changes now suddenly to 49 to 51. So we've got Maine, Susan Collins now going over with the Democrats. And if the Democrats can pull off, you know, anybody else, basically any other Republican, then the Republicans will be at 50, the Democrats will be at 50, and Mike Pence will be the vice president tiebreaker, who would then be responsible for actually appointing essentially that judge, right? He's the decision maker at that point in time per the U.S. Constitution. So if they're able to pull off any more people, if the Democrats can actually take off, you know, can pull two, three, or four Republicans over, then they will be successful in stopping her nomination to the Supreme Court. So we'll see if that happens. For some reason, to me, it just doesn't feel like it will. To me, it feels like the volume on this thing is a little bit lower than I would have suspected. And we'll see if it stays that way, right? We'll see. I'm not sure if it is going to stay that way. Now, I wanted to show you another thing that we had that we were able to pull up from Ms. Coney Barrett's court opinions. So if you go over to the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, you can actually do a search and you can find all of the cases that Amy Coney Barrett actually authored. So I've gone through a few of them, but you can see here, these are all of them, right? So when she was appointed to the court way down in March, this was her first opinion, David Barnes' final opinion, and that was a criminal case. And she's just been slowly authoring them ever since. A couple civils, We've got a prisoner case. Usually those are habeas cases, civil cases. We got another criminal case. We've got another, you know, criminal, civil, lots of criminals back to back, more criminal cases. And we've got some dissents here. She concurs, files a concurring opinion. Then we've got, you know, another concurrence. We've got a dissent here, civil case. And, you know, there's a lot. So there is a lot to go through, but we haven't had the time to do that yet. But now that she's confirmed, we can start taking a look at some of these things. This was an opinion, looks like Hector Uriarte. This was decided September 15th. So just very, very soon, very, very recently. Looks like this was a full court opinion. So she joined in this. And you can read through some of these. Hector Uriarte was a member of a gang that conspired to kidnap and rob drug dealers, several offenses, commit kidnapping, mandatory minimum. Okay, so this is a First Step Act type of a case. So the First Step Act said, basically it looks like what happened here was there was a gentleman, Ms. Uriarte, who was subjected to 42 years of imprisonment based on the original charges. The First Step Act was passed by the Trump administration, which reset that or actually modified some of the sentencing terms, provided for more lenient sentencing. And so Mr. Uriarte is then now appealing and saying, I want my sentence to be the lower sentence, which was passed by the First Step Act. And the court is basically going to be saying no. That because you were already sentenced under the old statute, that they're going to hold you according to that old statute. So in other words, they're not going to give him the benefit of the First Step Act on that one. Here's the Tony Sparkman case. Looks like here we've got another First Step Act case, same type of stuff. 5 years imprisonment, branding 25. Yeah, so they're going back again. They're talking about the mandatory sentencing. First Step Act has a lot of cases that are going through it. Let's take a look at one more. Oh, that's a concurrence. Jacqueline Kennedy Roby. Let's see what this opinion says. All right, she pled guilty to one count of mail fraud violation. She appeals, argues the district court failed to consider either her mental health condition or more lenient sentences received by defendants. We disagree, and she also argues that the sentence was substantively unreasonable, and we disagree. So here she's siding with the government, right? She said somebody's appealing their case, so they didn't look at my mental health. They didn't look at other similar sentences from around this court for the same types of offenses, and now they're saying that they're just going to affirm it. So that goes against the criminal defendant, right? And I don't know the specifics of this case. Obviously, these are massive opinions, and they take a lot of time to dissect. But I fully suspect that we will be knowing a lot more about Ms. Coney Barrett in the upcoming days and weeks. So that is what I wanted to cover today. Just some initial thoughts, some initial reactions. Let's hop in on the chat in the upcoming day and see if there are any other questions or any other thoughts that we can entertain. So what does everybody think about Amy Coney Barrett? We have a new nominee on the Supreme Court. Let's take a look. All right. Yeah. RAS Illusion says it is a done deal. I think I agree with that. I think it is pretty much a done deal at this point. Not real sure that they're going to have any ability to stop it. Free Climb says, I heard she pulled a kitty's tail when she was three. My sources are impeccable. They are all anonymous and none of them were there. Yeah, faction-based politics is detrimental to liberty. RAS Illusion says George Washington warned us all about the reality. We ought to listen. I agree with that. Yeah, and I'm hopeful. You know, I understand that things are really tense and politics are sort of ripping people apart these days. But it would be nice, you know, if a nice woman with a nice family who is highly qualified just, you know, has at least a civil confirmation process, right? I mean, can we just ask her the tough questions, you know, hit her hard with the legal stuff? What are you going to do? You know, and those types of questions are appropriate. But if they manufacture something, you know, from Lord knows where, like in my opinion, they did with Kavanaugh. And again, this is not a left versus right thing. This was a case where they were going after him with evidence that was 25 or 30 years old and had not been brought up at that point in time. So he could have been a defendant. He could have been a client. He could have been any innocent person would have, you know, who had somebody coming out after 25 or 30 years and making accusations against them at a moment when they're supposed, you know, when this is a critical juncture in their life, it just didn't sit right. I don't think that case would have held up in criminal court even a little bit. Like, I don't think that case would have even been charged as a crime by a prosecutor. They would have read the facts of that case and said, no, you don't get to file that 30 years later with no evidence. And, you know, they had some journals and some high school yearbooks and things like that. Like, give me a break. So if they try to do anything like that again, I think the country was pretty grossed out about that entire Kavanaugh hearing, regardless of the politics. You know, we saw that image of Kavanaugh's wife just sitting there, just emotionally devastated over this thing. And, you know, and he's a very, very similar type of character to Amy Coney Barrett, somebody who's highly, highly qualified, regardless of his politics. You can, and I would have made these same arguments for Kagan or Sotomayor, right? These people, their politics on a lot of issues I disagree with, they are much better on criminal justice reform than the conservatives are. So, you know, you got to weigh those things. But I would have given them the same credibility, the same, you know, decorum. We want to have a country that is working together towards the same thing. We're all rowing in the same direction. We don't need to kill each other over this stuff. So we'll see how that unfolds. I'm not going to hold my breath about it, but we will see. I'm dying to hear that chat about her views on felon rights. Appointing justices is like a roulette game. Trump gets 3 in his first year, and Obama got 2 in 8 years. Yeah, that was a weird, that's pretty weird, right? And what if Trump gets another term, and then he's got the possibility that Breyer, you know, Breyer's, I think, 87, and he's also got Thomas, who might at that point in time decide that he's gonna retire before the next term ends. So, you know, could you imagine if that happened and he got 5 picks? Oh my gosh! If you thought people were upset now, I mean, the whole world is would go bananas. The legal world especially. So I saw another article previously. Where was this? This was on Drudge Report. Let's see here. Let's see if I can find it. There's an article from Drudge Report that said, yeah, here it is. This came over from, it looks like, this is DNYUZ. It looks like Ginsburg, Obama, and the lunch that could have altered the Supreme Court history. So this article says that Obama tried to talk Ruth Bader Ginsburg of essentially getting out of, you know, let's have you retire so that we can go ahead and make that second appointment. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, they had lunch, private dining room, sought to keep the evening quiet, treading lightly, did not directly bring up the subject of retirement to Justice Ginsburg, who was 80 at the time, the oldest member and a 2-time cancer patient. He did say 2014 elections, they might lose the election and so on. And in an interview a year later, Justice Ginsburg deflected questions about the purpose of the lunch. I think he would agree with me it's a question for my own good judgment. Well, it was not good judgment. I mean, it wasn't, right? I mean, she's a judge, and people, you know, you can't really beat around that bush. She had the opportunity. Obama had the White House for 8 years, and she had the opportunity to retire, and she didn't. Trump is in the same situation with Thomas. Now, he's already gotten 3 picks, so this is a situation where he's, you know, doing very well in terms of his ability to appoint people to the Supreme Court. But if Thomas is also old, you know, so what happens if he doesn't retire like right now and Biden wins? Then the Republicans would have made the same miscalculations that the Democrats made. Let's take a look back at the comments. We've got Seref Creed, as long as the felony was a nonviolent crime against another person, probably talking about you know, the right to possess firearms after you're convicted of a felony. Thomas should step down tonight. Alpha Fox Adam says, B1 Solidarity says Ginsburg was evil. Devil emoji. We have RES Illusion says Trump will appoint 2 more, and there's a possibility of 3 more if Sotomayor has health problems. That is why they went all in with Kavanaugh. They see that coming. Yeah, that would be a big, big deal. Do you think, this one comes from Colin McLeod, do you think that Biden and the Democrats, if they win the presidency and the Senate, will pack the court? So I think that there will be a movement to try to do that. I really don't know how that will work. I really don't think the country is in the mood for that. I understand they have the authority to do it. I understand it's in the Constitution, but to me, it just feels like on a political level, like it's changing the rules of the game a little bit. And they would have to appoint a lot of people in order to secure power back. So I actually have some slides on that. This is what court packing looks like. Let me pull this up because I think this helps to illustrate just how big of a move this would be. So we've got court packing. Give me 1 second. They really would have to add a lot of people over onto the court. So this is what it looks like when we've got, so this is the current court, right? This is basically it right now. We're talking about these people right here. And if they want to change it back into their power, right? So we have these nine people. This is all the Supreme Court allows us to appoint. This one is going to be replaced by Amy Coney Barrett. And this is going to be the court makeup. So if they wanted to change it from a 6-3 into a 6-7 so that they have the power of the court back, they got to appoint four more people. That's a big deal. And the country, you know, I just don't know if they're going to look at that favorably, if they're going to think that that is a good thing to do at that point in time, you know, to give one president, whoever that is, and in particular Joe Biden. So say Joe Biden wins, they win the Senate, and now they have to appoint four new judges just because. I don't know how well that would sit. I think there might be some pretty big backlash to that. FDR tried it and there was some backlash for him. The country was not happy about it, but it worked. I mean, the Supreme Court, if you read those opinions, after FDR tried to pack the court, I think he wanted to go up to 15. I don't remember exactly. The Supreme Court originally was really striking down all of his legislation. He was doing all this New Deal stuff to try to kickstart the economy, and he wanted to pack the court because the judges on the Supreme Court just kept throwing this stuff out. They just said, nope, unconstitutional. You don't have the right to do that. No executive authority, blah, blah, blah. And he said, all right, that's fine. We're going to go ahead and just pack the court. So we're just going to go ahead and turn it into 13 or 15 or whatever it was. And the judges, after that point in time, we go through this in constitutional law, suddenly they just start flipping the other direction. They just start saying, sure, that sounds good. Yeah, you want that program? No problem. You can do that under the Commerce Clause power. You can do that under the taxation power. That sounds reasonable. That sounds like a tax. And so we started to see this really just sort of massive expansion of government authority to tax and regulate and to do all of these things that were sort of born out of a scared Supreme Court changing back. Now, remember, the Supreme Court is all about legitimacy. When we talk about the Supreme Court, you know, their power, do they have any authority to go in and enforce the law? Do they have the same agencies that the president does? No, and that's by design. They don't have any of those powers. The executive has the Department of Justice, which has the FBI, right? I mean, this is a massive enforcement wing of the executive branch. Their duty is to enforce the law. The Supreme Court's duty is not to enforce the law. So the Supreme Court has a big problem. The only reason they have any power or any authority is because of the legitimacy that society gives to it. We say, yeah, it's the Supreme Court. You know, we've all made this agreement that the Congress writes the laws, the president executes the laws, and the judiciary measures the laws. Are they constitutional or not? And if the court loses that legitimacy, then the court loses its power. And I think this was a big reason why we've seen a lot of the sort of flip-floppy, squishy opinions out of Chief Justice Roberts. We thought that he was going to be a very conservative judge going in. He was appointed under Bush. And he turned out to sort of really be creeping towards the middle. If you remember the Affordable Care Act decision, this was one in which Justice Roberts actually joined with the liberals, even though he's, you know, quote, a conservative judge. He decided that that case was a taxation case, and he gave the authority to the Obama administration and said they can run with it. Go ahead with the Affordable Care Act, no problem. And in my opinion, the reason why he did that was because it was the court's legitimacy. The court's authority was weighing in the balance. You know, he had just been appointed. We had a new president. It was the first black president that we've ever had. The country was really unified in one direction. It was the first huge domestic policy. I say domestic violence because I'm so used to saying that. It was the first domestic policy that the president Obama was able to implement. And so if the court would have invalidated his signature domestic legislation, Justice Roberts, in my opinion, was going to think that this would have really crippled the legitimacy of the court. It would have been a 5-4 decision, and it would have gone against Obama in a time when the country is just moving so, you know, there was a wave of Obama enthusiasm in that election. And so the Chief Justice didn't want to impede that, which I understand that argument. Doesn't make for good case law, but I understand the argument and I understand the rationale. And so if the Democrats try to do that, if they try to tilt the court by just appointing 4 new judges out of nowhere based on, you know, the expansion of the Supreme Court, what is that going to do to the legitimacy of the Supreme Court? In my opinion, it eviscerates it. And I think even Justice Ginsburg, there's some other articles from her saying that she disagrees with court packing because the legitimacy of the court would be severely undermined, and it wouldn't be good for anybody. All right. Yeah, John Q says Justice Roberts is absolutely not a conservative. I think that's a pretty good consensus. It was in 2012 before the election. That was the Obamacare decision. So I think what I meant was after 2008. I think that's the time frame when I was talking about. Ordered liberty cannot and never did truly mean liberty is ordered by government. That lie is being fried more and more each day. RAS Illusion has just very succinct, very poignant comments about liberty. I love it. If you're going to pack the court, you're going to need to make an amendment to the Constitution. 2/3 of both houses and 3/4 of the states. Good luck with that. Stop doing a disservice to your viewers. That's actually not accurate. I think what you're talking about is the Congress can establish the size of the court. Congress can just by will just change the size of the court. They can expand the judiciary. They can contract it. That's all in the Constitution. I think I have a slide on that somewhere, but I'm not going to look for it right now. I think maybe what you're talking about is this idea that there was new legislation that we talked about, I think yesterday, from 3 Democrats who apparently are not constitutional scholars, who said that they wanted to impose term limits on the judges. They wanted to limit it to 18 years, and then they had to withdraw off the court. That absolutely would require a constitutional amendment, because the Constitution says they are allowed to stay in office during which time they have good behavior. In other words, so as long as they're not breaking the law, as long as they don't get impeached, then they can stay on the court. So to ask them to sort of give up their term under a life term, to drop that down to 18 years, that would require a constitutional amendment. And there is absolutely no way that that is going to be happening, right? The states, 3/4 of the states are not going to ratify any amendment to the Constitution. So the lifetime tenure on the Supreme Court appointments is not going anywhere anytime soon. The size of the court could absolutely change. I think Congress, if the Senate goes to the Democrats and the House goes to the Democrats and they get the presidency, I think that it could. I don't know whether it would, because politically I think it would be sort of a disaster. Is the Constitution 100% literal? So this comes from Colin McLeod. Can you talk about necessary and proper clause? Yeah, it's a great question. So necessary and proper is the Constitution 100% literal, I think, is a better question to start off with. So it's a question that this is sort of what we're fighting about, right? When we're talking about the left wing of the court and the right wing of the court, there are differing judicial philosophies on how they read the Constitution. So there are literally different techniques and tactics on how to read and apply and interpret the Constitution. So Amy Coney Barrett and Justice Scalia are on the originalist side of that argument. So when they read the Constitution, they are trying to read it as literally as possible. They literally look at the language and they say, okay, this is what the founding fathers said back in the 1700s. This is what their interpretation was. So we look at the language and we shove it in context within the 1700s and we say, okay, this is what they were really talking about. When they said search and seizure, what they meant is people coming like literally into their home without a warrant and searching around and then taking things back to the British crown, right? That's sort of what they were talking about. And so when they say, well, we don't have the British crown anymore, so that's not literal, so maybe we shouldn't interpret it as literally anymore, the left wing of the court says, well, that was in the 1700s. That doesn't apply anymore. Or the example we use with the left wing is, What about the right to keep and bear arms? So they'll go back and they'll say, well, the right to keep and bear arms, that was in the 1700s. That's when we were at war with Great Britain. This is when we had armed militias running around Lexington and Concord and all these different places. So for them, they would read that and say, that doesn't apply anymore. That applied in the 1700s, but not today. Today, we have semi-automatic weapons and hollow points and all sorts of technology that's designed to kill people. And they would say, that doesn't apply today. They're not interpreting the Constitution literally at all. They're saying, okay, like we get those general concepts, like firearms are important and protection's important and so on. So we're going to just interpret that part not so literally. We're going to say, sure, there are limits on magazines and you can't have certain barrel lengths and you can't have it if you're a felon or been charged with domestic violence. And they're going to put, impose all of these restrictions because they're not reading the Constitution so literally. They're just using it as sort of guideposts. And so there's this distinction between this evolving idea that the idea that the Constitution is continually evolving and they're reading more rights into it. So the judges will interpret some other areas of the Constitution and they'll say, we saw this a lot with the 14th Amendment and the incorporation of a lot of the Bill of Rights down into the states, where the court would say, well, we see this, they call it a penumbra in case law. It's called a penumbra or an umbrella of rights that they're sort of extracting from the Constitution based on the sequence of things that they're seeing in there. So they're seeing that the Constitution is promising freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of assembly, freedom against self-incrimination and all these things. So they'll read in another right. They'll say, well, if the Constitution has all of those things in it already, then we should read in other rights like, marriage and gay marriage now. And so they're reading in or extending certain privileges into other areas of law. And so there's argument that that's not originalist. You can't do that because that's not what the original Constitution says. You actually have to go in and modify it, right? If you want that type of change in the law, you don't get to just throw it in there because it sounds good and you think it's appropriate for 2020. They say, you got to go pass the law. And if you don't pass the law, sorry, then it stays the same. Because that's what they wrote in the 1700s. And the Constitution doesn't continually change. And it's not just the Constitution. It's all the other bills. So this goes through, this goes through anything. Any type of case law that they would be talking about would be about, how are you going to apply the law? So like in criminal law, let's say, for example, we do this a lot on this channel. When we look at Kyle Rittenhouse's case, or we look at Breonna Taylor's case, and we say, okay, here are the facts. Let's apply the facts to the law. Well, how are we going to interpret the law? In criminal law, it's very factual, right? It's this person was here, they did this. The law says they had to do this in order to be guilty of it. They didn't do that. Therefore, they're missing an element, and that doesn't apply. So that's a very simplistic way of doing statutory interpretation, but the concept is the same. There are others who want to look back and say that it doesn't really apply anymore because times have changed, versus people who say, yeah, it's literal. We're not even going to discuss it. This is how it is, and that's the right wing versus the left wing. Good channel. Good question. I was reading somebody else's comments. John Q says, I like this channel. I think you do a great job. Thanks, John. Thanks for being here. And if you haven't already subscribed, hit the subscribe button because we have a lot of views on this channel, but not that many subscribers, I think, relative to the views. So that means a lot of people are just watching and leaving. And that hurts. That hurts my feelings. So hit the subscribe button because we love having these conversations. This is an impromptu live stream. Just wanted to hop on and do some reaction to what we saw this afternoon. While I know it's on top of everybody's mind, but we are doing a live stream now every day at 4 p.m. Arizona time, which is 7 p.m. Eastern time. And so subscribing is a good way to just be notified about that. We put a lot of content out, just a lot. We do a live show every week or every day of the week moving forward. And those all get spliced up and cut up and thrown on the channel and thrown everywhere else. So it's a lot of fun when we can have these conversations and I can respond to some of the comments. So I'm really glad that you're here. Thank you so much for being here. So Colin actually said, so I didn't answer the second part of Colin's questions, which was the necessary and proper clause. So the Constitution defines enumerated basically rights of what everybody can do, right? What the executive can do, the judiciary and the states have, and all of the other rights that are not enumerated are reserved to the people. So the people hold on to everything else. It's an interesting, we can dive into that another time, but the point is that there's a provision of the Constitution that says that the federal government has the authority to do what is necessary and proper to effectuate the other parts of the Constitution. So, for example, they can't say, this is just an example, but if the Constitution said, hey, it's okay to tax people, but they didn't provide a mechanism in which to do it, or they didn't give the Congress the authority to go collect that those taxes, then that taxation provision in the Constitution would be invalid. It would be without any weight, because if they couldn't go collect it, what good is it saying that they can do it? So the government would say, well, you owe me this money. And we would say, well, we're not going to pay you that money. And the government needs a method of recourse to go collect that from you. So the Constitution provides some provisions for Congress and for the government establishment in its entirety. You actually establish what is necessary. If it's necessary to go accomplish something, the Constitution authorizes the governing bodies to go do that. So that's not a very articulate explanation, but it's just basically given the government the tools it needs to go effectuate the provisions that are allowed in the under the Constitution. And there's a lot of case law on that, and we can really argue about that. What is necessary? What is proper? And we have all these different standards of review for different statutes. What can the government do? What can they limit? Is it necessary for the government to do that? Or should the government use the least restrictive means possible in order to effectuate their end goals? So there's a lot of discussion. We spend a lot of time in constitutional law specifically talking about it, but it's a great question. This Gruler person is some kind of constitutional expert? I don't know that I'd say that I'm an expert, but I am a lawyer, and I did take constitutional law in law school, and I studied it a lot. And I did pretty well in constitutional law. Actually, I think one semester I was the highest scoring student in that class. So I love the Constitution. I got what's called a Cali Award, C-A-L-I. You can look it up. It's for performing well and doing things in school. I love the Constitution. I love this country. I love our founding documents. Super important to me. It's a big reason I do this channel and this show, is because I feel like a lot of the time, the people we elect, the people we put in positions of power, they don't hold the same reverence for those documents that I do. They are a lot more comfortable, whether they're Republicans or Democrats or police or prosecutors or judges or other politicians, it doesn't matter. But a lot of those people, in my opinion, they don't have the same reverence that I do for the Bill of Rights, for civil liberties, for protecting people who are otherwise defenseless, as they're just trying to live their lives. I understand people make mistakes, but we want to help them through the justice system. And so, I'm not like Erwin Chemerinsky. If you want to look for a constitutional expert, look up Erwin Chemerinsky. I'll bring his book, his constitutional law book. This guy wrote a book about this thick, and then he wrote a companion book that's about this thick to explain his book. So we have a textbook on constitutional law that's probably about this big, and his companion book is about this big. And that's like him just getting started. He is a constitutional scholar, so I would refer you over to him. Alpha Fox Adam says, I probably tallied in con law as well, but only because I used Westlaw to find a case that the take-home final was based on. That's a good strategy. Work smarter, not harder, man. I'm all about that, so good for you. It can be difficult to differentiate between having the right to your own opinion but not your own facts. Colin, the framers did imagine technology changing, and that point itself has been through the courts over and over and over. Gun controllers lost that argument also. Yeah, and the ability to amend is proof they did envision those things and could not, the things they could not possibly imagine. I think her views can be seen simply from what I've seen. She believes a felon has a right to vote and bear arms. I think she has this view as they are one in the same. And yeah, I think that is right. And let me see if I have that opinion here, because I believe I do. Yes, here is the opinion. Here is the Second Amendment opinion from Amy Coney Barrett. So this one was Cantor versus William Barr, the Attorney General. And Barrett was one of the circuit judges here. And so she didn't actually, she dissents in this case. So this is a Seventh Circuit opinion on firearms. It says here, Ricky Cantor, he pled guilty to one count of mail fraud due to his felony conviction. He is prohibited from possessing a firearm under both federal and Wisconsin law. At issue is whether the felon disposition statute violate the Second Amendment as applied. So what does that mean? It means that this guy was convicted of a federal crime, and he, as a result of that, if you're convicted of a felony in the United States, you lose your right to possess a firearm. You're no longer allowed to own weapons. It's called being a prohibited possessor. So in this case, he was a prohibited possessor, and he's challenging that. He's saying whether or not I can actually be dispossessed of my firearm because I was convicted of a felony. And in the Seventh Circuit, this case is interesting. The court affirmed it. So the court said, yep, statute is fine. You can continue to, you're no longer allowed to have any weapons or firearms because the law says you can't have them. And Judge Barrett, Amy Coney Barrett, dissented. So the court said no firearms. She said he should have firearms. And this, the distinction she uses is whether a felon is dangerous or not. So the law as it stands now says if you're a felon, that's it. No firearms. You're gone. Applies in Arizona, applies across the country as far as I know. I don't practice in every state, but I think that every single state actually upholds that rule. So no, if you're a felon, no firearms at all, period. Doesn't matter what type of felony. So there are people who've been charged with marijuana violations, for example, which in Arizona are still felony offenses. If that, I'm not kidding about that, right? If you have possession of marijuana in Arizona, the leaf, just the green leaf, it's a class 6 felony. If you are in possession of a vape pen or anything that's distilled down, like, you know, gummies or edibles or any of that stuff, it's a class 4 felony. It's called possession of narcotic drugs. And it is a severe thing. You lose your right to firearms. You're charged with a felony. You got to go through superior court. It's a big deal. And so, according to the rules, if you're convicted of that marijuana possession offense, you are now a felon, and that means you don't get to vote and you don't get to possess a firearm. In this case, the Second Amendment case from Amy Coney Barrett, she's talking about that's not enough. She's saying just because you were convicted of a felony, this guy was convicted of a mail fraud felony, which would be analogous to a marijuana or a drug charge felony, and the government is saying no firearms for that. Amy Coney Barrett says, no. The distinction, the key question should be dangerousness. So she's talking about whether it is actually dangerous. She wants to know whether, she says that power extends only to people who are dangerous. Founding era legislatures did not strip felons of the right to bear arms simply because of their status as felons. So this goes back to another question we answered previously. She's interpreting the statute. She's taking it back to the founding era. She's saying back then, this is how they interpreted that rule. They said back in the 1700s, during our founding, they never would have prohibited somebody from having a firearm just because they're felons. No evidence about it. Such restrictions applied to civic rights like voting and jury service, not to individual rights like possessing a gun. So she distinguishes between dangerous and non-dangerous, and also civic rights like voting and individual rights like possessing a gun. So based on this opinion, she's saying that, you know, gun rights are even stronger than what the federal courts are saying. So that felons are also entitled to have firearms, provided that they're not dangerous, which is much more in alignment with the Second Amendment proponents, of which I am one. So, you know, this is another case that is sort of on the favor of the defense, of the small guys, of the little guys, which I'm in favor of. So that's another interesting question. We'll see how that continues to go. All right. Well, listen, everybody, this is about it for me. I had a lot of fun talking through this stuff with you. Great questions. Thank you so much. Let me do one more. Can private citizens legally own nuclear weapons, and is banning them from owning nukes against the Second Amendment? I haven't seen any case law on that. I haven't seen any statutes on that, but I'm going to guess that it is highly illegal to possess a nuclear weapon without some sufficient credentials or qualifications authorized by the federal government. Probably the, what's it called? The nuclear NIE, something nuclear, something or other. I think that's pretty highly regulated. But that's it for me, everybody. I want to thank you so much for being here today. A lot of fun talking with you. We'll be back here next week on Monday, 4 p.m. Arizona time, which is Pacific time, 7 p.m. Eastern time. Hit the subscribe button if you've not already done that. If you have some friends who you think would love to join in on the conversation or dive into the chat, invite them to the show. You know, have them come back here. Hit the subscribe button as well, because we want to continue this. We want to continue to watch the watchers. There are a lot of problems There's a lot of misinformation out there. A lot of people are just operating and analyzing these issues off of sound bites and news clips and 2-minute snippets here and there. So we're going to do deeper dives here. We're going to dive into these issues. A lot of the time we cover, you know, police misconduct, prosecutorial misconduct, judicial misconduct, political misconduct. So we want, as the election is ramping up, we're going to see more and more of this. We're seeing protests and mayhem on the streets. And so this is a good spot to have a real clean conversation without ripping each other apart and just sort of diving into the facts and discussing it. So we'd love to see you back here next week. Have a great weekend and a wonderful afternoon. Bye-bye, everybody.